We're live.
Hi, everybody. And welcome to block four of our sew along. I wish you could see out the window right now. I can just see out the little part of my door. There's great, big, beautiful snowflakes coming down. Nice day to see my quilting buddies. So let's begin. So this block today we are doing is this one right here, and it's made up, it's a pinwheel, but it's made up only of flying geese, and there's just four of each of two different colors. So I am going to talk to you about a couple ways on how to do flying geese, and we're going to go on from there. Post in my colors, so you can see right there, beautiful green and this peach again with my dots. Tiffany's colors that she chose today are these beautiful snowman fabrics. And again, wanting to make sure that there's a value difference in between our flying geese, or a contrast, not necessarily a value, but at least a contrast, so they show up so we get to see that pinwheel. So there's a few different ways that we can do flying geese. I'm going to talk about a couple old school ways first. This is the first method here. So a lot of patterns, they would tell you to cut a square, something in 3/8 or something in 5/8, and you're going to cut it in 4 across the diagonal. You are also going to take two squares and cut them once across the diagonal. And the reason why we do this is because we want to make sure that the straight grain of our fabric along the edges of our block. So by cutting them on the diagonal, we have these pieces here. So you will take one large quarter square triangle and two half square triangles, and you would sew them on each side. Normally this method is you cut exact, sew exact, everything's perfect, only if you're perfect. We're also working with biases, so I don't like doing this method. I won't do that method. And I'm not going to do that. So that is method number one, though, if you want to do it that way. Method number two is you cut your square exactly to the size of the cut size of your flying goose. So in this case, we're doing a 3.5 by 6.5. So we would cut our square into 3.5 by 6.5. And then for each goose, we would cut two squares at 3.5 inches square. On the back of our square, we would draw a line from diagonal to diagonal, lie it on our flying goose. And now I want to sew, but I want to sew not exactly on the line. I have to make up for my fold over, my seam. So I want to sew just to say that I'm on the outside of that line. So I am using darker thread today than I normally would, just so hopefully you can see it a bit better. So again, I'm not sewing on either side of the line. I'm just sewing on the line. So now I will press. Before I go to my iron, I will make sure that this piece presses and lines up exactly with my green square. Remember, that was cut at the exact size we want. So if this seam is pressed and it's not lining up right to the side, we have to re-sew our seam. So once I know that it's good, I compress my seam, and then I am just going to trim off this side over here with a 1/4 inch seam. Now that's garbage, and it's going to go, you know, you could sew another little seam here, make another little half square triangle and throw it into your stash box. But theoretically, that's garbage. I will take my flying goose. I will put another square on this side and do exactly the same thing. And I have a goose. Really great if you have to make one goose. If you maybe you mess one up or the dog eats one and you only have to make one, I will use this method. But my most favorite method of making flying geese is using the the wing clipper from Studio. It is a really cool ruler because it has 10 different sizes. You can make right here. Let's put it on the white. You can make what right from a 1 by 1.5 inch flying goose all the way up to a 5.5 by 10 inch flying goose. So there's 10 different sizes. So it makes the ruler very economical. It is the method I want to use for flying geese. When you get your ruler, you have a little chart in there. So if I am doing a regular pattern and it says in the pattern that I'm going to be making, I always always study my pattern first. So what I want to do is see what the units are in the quilt, or sorry, in the pattern, that quilt, and if there's some way that I can change them and tuckerize them to use the rulers that we like. So there's a chart in with our ruler, all the finished sizes of the flying geese and all the cut sizes. So in this case, if you were looking at the pattern and it said you had to do a flying goose unit and they told you to cut those rectangles at 2.5 by 4.5, that's cut size. So I would go down to the 2.5 by 4.5. Then I would cut my large square, which is the quarter square triangle. I like to think of that as the goose part. And then the small squares are cut at 3 inches. And I like to think of those as the wings. And it just keeps it a little bit clearer in my head. So one user called West End Quilter said, "Hi, everyone. Don't forget to click on the thumbs up icon below to get more positive feedback for Cindy," which is a wonderful reminder. Thank you so much. Also, Leanne said she tuned in from Vancouver today and asked if we started early. We haven't really even started yet, Leanne. We were just showing some different methods of doing the flying geese. We're starting our block right now, I believe.
We're going to start it right now. Exactly. So if I was doing this at home, I would just continually sew both blocks at the same time. I'm just going to do them 1 by 1 this time. So I will be able to do my first block and then we will be able to review on the second block. I have a hard time with my tongue today. So I'm going to take one block, my large block, 5.5, and my 4 4-inch squares. 7.5. I'm sorry, 7.5, and my 4 4-inch squares. On the back of my 4-inch squares, I drew one diagonal line from corner to corner. So here is the biggest mistake that we make if we're doing that ruler. Normally, when we line fabric up, we want to align the edges absolutely perfect. In this case, it has some fudge room built in, so we don't want to do that. We want to smoosh it in about 1/16 of an inch. We are going to do that with both squares. And that's going to allow us to square up our geese. It's going to give us that little bit of room. So I'm just going to throw a pin in here. Throw a pin in here so I don't drop them when I go back to my sewing machine. And now I am going to sew on either side of this line with my 1/4-inch foot. I am just going to put my other 1/4-inch foot on because I like it. Again, I have set my sewing machine to 2.0. Again, because this is a bias, I want to make sure that that's going to work really well. I'm going to start with my needle in the down position. Butt that up and away we go. And I don't care what kind of sewing machine, if you have a really expensive one or not, you either have to put a leader in it or you have to hold your thread tails. And my thread broke. What happened? The joys of live television.
easy fix. I have got more thread here than you can shake a stick at. I'm just going to sew on a leader right now just to make sure, because it thread break, I want to make sure that my bobbin's in there right. So I'm just going to sew in this first. We're good to go. Okay, so I've picked up my block and I brought it here, and I'm just going to eyeball that again, make sure nothing shifted. I'm going to put my needle down, lift by foot. And I'm just going to continue sewing just back onto my other square. I'm going to flip it around and I'm going to sew right back down the other side. So if this was real life and I was really doing this to make the block, I would at this point grab my next squares and continue on doing exactly the same thing. Once my brain does it once, it's easy to do it the second time. But for today, we're going to do. Okay. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut down that middle line. Not the sewing line, but the drawn line. I'm going to grab my ironing pad. So let's talk about pressing for a minute. So I want to press towards my small triangles. So I'm going to have my unit with the triangles at the top. This edge that we cut now, our seam, it's a bias. You can see that I could literally stretch that really terribly. So I want to make sure that I have no steam on, and I want to set that so it's nice and straight. So set that seam into our fabric, and now I am going to open this as well as I can without stretching. And then I'm just going to press with my iron. I don't want to warp it at all. So I've got one. So then you're going to have two little heart shaped things, or one of my quilting buddies calls them foxes. Press and press. So now we have these two little units here, and we have two more squares. We're going to do exactly the same thing. We're going to place our square in the corner that doesn't have anything on it. So our drawn line goes diagonally from the corner. Again, making sure that I've smooshed that in that 16th of an inch or so. It's really important. I can put a pin in here, and off I go. Grab my starter. Because we're sewing corners on triangles and stuff, if your sewing machine seems to be pushing the corner of your triangle into your bed of your machine, into the little hole of your needle plate, you probably have to change your needle. Needles get dull, just like knives. They're sharp, but they, especially if you've maybe hit something or hit a pin, if you were sewing over a pin by accident. So if it does start pushing your corner into your machine, chances are you need a new needle. Thank you. again, I sewed all the way down, flipping it around. I'm just going to, I lost my scissors. There they are. Cut that leader off. Sew back down this side. At this point, I'm going to stop with that unit because it's holding my threads where I want to go. I'm going to grab my next unit. I'm going to align that square up again, making sure that 16th of an inch is smooshed in. That's an actual quilting term, eh? Smooshed. One. I can cut this off and do two. So now when I cut these units apart, one, two, and when I open these up again, we're pressing towards the seam. You can see there's our flying goose, a little bit oversized. So let's square these ones up, or let's just press them first. I'm having issues with my tongue today. There are a lot of people that are having issues because of the snowstorm, getting blurry images or no sound. I do want to remind everyone, hopefully you can hear me. We'll be left up afterwards, and usually the video afterwards is a higher definition, so that's good. Oh. It's a really snowy day, and I know the only service that I can get here is Bell. And they have very old lines in the area. We were told that there's microscopic cracks in the lines and that there's nothing that they can do about it.
There's nothing they will do
about it. Or there's, yeah. So let's press this. Whoops. I want to make sure that it's pressed open all the way again, because I am wanting to go towards the small. I start with my small square on top. There we go. So now I have four oversized flying geese, and we're going to square them up. So we're going to do this in two cuts. So the very first cut I'm going to do is I'm going to place the goose on the table with its nose pointing towards me. On the ruler, let me get my whiteboard here. On the roller, you can see all these diagonals. Those are for our seam lines. So I know that my square is, I'm squaring it up to 3.5 by 6.5. So I want to find that little nose just above that line.
I'm just going to move closer to you so I can get a better visual of the lines for them.
Okay, so you can see here again, here's my 3.5 inch line. That point right there is what I want to put on the nose of my goose. I will take the two diagonals and I will line them both up with my seam. And I think you can tell that I have a little bit of fabric on the outside of my 3.5 by 6.5 and a little bit of fabric on the outside of my ruler. That's exactly what I want to do. So because I have this little X here, I know that I'm not going to lose anybody's nose when I trim up. This ruler is a little bit slippery. So there's a couple things that we can do. There's InvisiGrip.
Does your other one have stuff on it?
I don't know. Nope. That's a tube. Okay. I found this new product, and I am using it on my quilting rulers, the ones that I use for my long arm or the ones we use for ruler work. And it's a coating for the back that's, it's grippy. It's not sticky, but it just gives it a little bit of rough. I am going to put it on my wing clipper right now, live, to see if it's something that we want to do. A lot of times we use what's called Invisigrip, which is a cling film that goes on the back that reduces the slip. But let's see. Okay, I'm going to spray it off camera. I am just, so it really hasn't changed my view. That's not too bad. But if you felt it right now, it feels just a little bit rough. How do you explain that, Tiff?
Not tacky.
It's just a little bit of a rough surface. So now it's not slipping on me like it was before. That works really well.
It's almost like that fake etching spray.
Exactly. Almost feels like a little bit of sand, but not really.
But it's removable. So it, like, it's not etching your ruler. It is removable.
It will come off eventually all by itself. Or you can also buy a remover. Okay, so I've lined up those lines again. That corner that's just up past my 3.5. Those two diagonals are on my seams. Everything's perfect. It didn't slide this time when I went to go cut. I'm at a little bit of a funny angle because of the camera. So that's why my ruler slipped. I couldn't be right exactly over top of it. That stuff works really well. Alrighty. So now I have a perfect corner. My upper right is going into my bottom left. One really nice thing about all the Deb Tucker rulers in her paper, she has diagrams on how to do it for the lefties as well. So it hasn't left it up to you to try to figure out how to use her tool. She has it all written out for you, which is really nice. So I'm going to take that 6.5 and that 3.5 inch line, and I am now going to put it on the edge of my block like I normally do. Right up here, there's a little X. I've got the one diagonal here and the little X, and that fits exactly on my nose. If for some reason I grab the wrong line, I don't have that X there, you know that I'm on the wrong line. Again, 3.5 by 6.5. My little X is there. And that's ensuring that we're going to have our quarter inch seam and I'm not going to cut my goose's nose off. One, two. So not much waste.
And just, by cut her goose's nose off, she means lose her point.
Exactly. Exactly. Not a lot of waste. But I have a perfect goose now without having to so absolutely stress. It really does reduce the stress. I'm not trying so hard to be perfect because I know that I have that little bit of fudge room in there. Okay, again, to recap, my points towards my tummy, finding that X over top of my 3, aligning up my lines. They're fitting nicely. Square up. Square up. Upper right to bottom left. My 3.5 by 6.5 inch line. Square up. Yeah, I'm hoping one of these are off. This one might be. Okay. I'm hoping one of them's off so I can tell you how to fix it, and I'll show you why it'd be off. Yep, perfect. Okay, so I've sewed them all, and I've sewed them all exactly, and I go to measure off this one. So I'm going to find that X that's over top of my 3.5. I'm going to align this line up on my seam. And can you focus in a little bit right here? Okay. It's my line on my ruler is not on my seam anymore. Now, because I sewed crooked, it's because I caught my iron on that seam and it stretched it. So all I'm going to do is I am going to fix it. I'm going to grab my iron. I'm going to put a little bit of steam on. I'm going to press this back. And I just scratched with my fingers to put it back to kind of where I want it to be.
I
And this time steam is my friend. Because I stretched it, I want to shrink it back to where it's supposed to be. I'm going to lie this on here. And you can see now, I'm good to go. Ta-da! Okay, just move our ironing board. Now we can square this up. Sometimes steam can be our friend. Most of the time it's our enemy, but sometimes it can be our friend. 6.5, my point. And one more. See, and this one worked out again. And I figured because, remember, I caught my iron on that seam, I thought that would be the one that might be off. But it was an easy fix. That sticky stuff is really good. I don't want to call it the grippy stuff. I'm not going to call it sticky because it's not sticky. Because at first when I seen the cans, I thought, oh, you know, I don't want to use that because it's going to collect all the threads on the bottom. It really doesn't. Odif. So that's again what I use, the grippy non-stick coating. Odif makes the 505 spray, which we've been using for years. Alrighty, so I've got 4 flying geese, and because we're doing this live and we have lots of time, I have to make my second set. And it just gives us another recap. Is there any questions so far on flying geese? It's one of the very common blocks in quilting. So that's why I really like the ruler. I don't like rulers that I'm going to use just once and then just throw in a drawer somewhere. But this one I just use over and over and over again. Again, my 7.5-inch square. And it doesn't matter which one I put on first, whether this one overlaps or that one overlaps. It really doesn't matter. And again, make sure that's all aligned nicely. Going to hit my pin. Let me pull that out. Flip around. One of the things with flying geese, most of the times when we're using them in our quilt, we don't usually make just one or two. Usually they're for points of stars or units like these pinwheels. So they usually you do need 4 at a time. So if I only needed one, I would go back to this method that I did over here. We're sewing the square on and flipping and sewing.
Someone asked, if we do not have the wing clipper ruler yet, what method do you recommend for the traditional piecing?
Okay, so I still recommend this method, and I'll show you how to square it up with my 6.5-inch ruler. How's that? So I will square one of these up when I get there. Good point. Good question. So by using this method, I'm still going to have a little bit of fudge room. And then I'm still going to square them up.
And you're not wasting any fabric this way too.
Whoops.
This one's being cranky.
Those points really want to bend. Oh, got my steam on. Turn the steam off. So now I have my little fox faces or my little hearts. Make sure that my diagonal line's going from the corner. Smooshing it in against that 16th of an inch. And off we go. Going to cut those on the line. Because we're doing it in this method, you will see that this one, the right hand wing, small square, is on the top, and this one, the left, is on the top. Doesn't matter, because when we sew it into our next unit, we're going to be sewing right at that point. So it doesn't matter which one flips on top. And pressing. Whoops. One. So I have my 6.5 inch ruler. So now I have to do a little bit of math in my head. So if I'm squaring it up to 6.5 inch wide, I need to keep my point in the center point. So half of 6.5 is 3 1/4. So I have to find the 3 1/4 inch line on my ruler, and I have to find where it dissects that 1/4 inch seam. So if I place it this way, I want to make sure that that 1/4 inch seam, or that 3 1/4 inch mark, lines up with my point. I want to make sure that I have my 1/4 inch along, and then I have fabric around in between the 3.5 to the 6.5. That being said, I could have this off at an angle. So for this point, I want to again start with my point down at the center. I want to use my diagonal line, and I want to find my 3 1/4 inch mark. 3 1/4, that little on this Creative Grids one, it is that little chicken foot right there. I want to align that up here. So I have my 3.5 inch line, my 6.5 inch line. I've got a little bit of fabric all the way around, but I'm going to use this diagonal on my ruler.
I'm going to find that 3 1/4, which is half of 6 1/2. Place it right on that point. I'm going to square these two sides. Perfect corner, upper right, now goes to the bottom left. I'm going to find my 6 1/2 inch line on my ruler. This is a 7 1/2 inch. I thought we had a 6 1/2. Doesn't matter. It's fine. Again, so I've got my 3 1/2 inch line on the outside. I've got my 3 1/4 inch line dissecting my point, and my 1/4 inch line on my ruler across the top. I'm going to this one and this one, and I have a perfect goose.
This one's
okay. No, yeah. Hey, if we don't have this ruler and we have the Tucker Trimmer ruler, I'm sure that we can do exactly the same thing with it. So I've got my diagonal. The only thing with this one is I've got my diagonal and I have the double diagonal on the ruler. Remember when we were squaring up trying to keep this point in the middle of a block? So here's my 6 1/2 inch diagonal and my constant diagonal. So I'm going to put this diagonal on that seam. My 6 1/2 inch, because I know I'm squaring it up to 6 1/2 inch on that seam. I've got a little bit of fabric all the way around. You have to spray this one too. Perfect corner, upper right, lower left. Now I only have a partial line on my ruler here, but that's okay. I'll make sure that's straight. My 6 1/2, my 3 1/2. I still have I have a diagonal here that says 3 1/2. It's working well on my seam. I can square. So just because you don't have the tools that I recommend, we can still do the block. Just takes a little bit more thinking, having to do a little bit of math and figuring out the lines. And again, so again, because this one has the double diagonal, of course, the wing clipper would be my first choice. The checker trimmer is my second. But if we have the regular square with a diagonal on one, that would be my third choice. So I've got two more. So we'll go over it one more time with the wing clipper. Point towards our tummy. We always start that way. Finding my seam lines. I have fabric all the way around. If you don't have enough fabric on one side, it's probably because you didn't squish your block in far enough. Sometimes we might have to fudge it a little bit. I've also had, I'm going to cut this one a little bit crooked because I don't know if you could see. Okay, so say this corner here lined up perfectly with your ruler, but my edge of my fabric, I don't know if you can see this. Mm-hmm. Can you see that? It doesn't quite line up with the edge of my block, but I had that little nose sticking out. So if I use that as the nose, so when I block to sew it together, I would align this corner and I would align that corner, and that little eighth of an inch, put it on this side, you can see better. That little 16th of an inch that it's out is going to be in our seam allowance, and nobody's going to know by the time our quilt's sewn together. Just to make sure that the line is straight. I hope you understand what I meant. But let's square this up. My two diagonals, my point just over my 3 1/2. And, you know, I really do say it to myself all the time when I am squaring up. I'm always making sure that my lines are there, my X is on my point. And I say it sort of in my head. I have a way that I say it that it's always the same so I don't forget a step. Again, we can use the Tucker trimmer on this one. our regular constant diagonal here. We've got our 6.5 inch line.
Why don't you go over it again with the
cream with the other one in case they don't have that one? They don't have the type of trimmer. Okay, so 6.5 inch. I have to figure out what the center point is. So half of 6.5 is 3.25. I'm going to put my diagonal from the upper right to the bottom left, and I am going to find that 3.25 inch mark right there. And I will put that right on the point of my goose. I have a little bit of fabric all the way around. Square up. Perfect corner, upper right, bottom left. Now I'm going to use my 6.5 inch line and my 3.5 inch line. My 3.25, where it intersects my 1/4 inch seam line, is right at that point. Square up, square up. So you can see I didn't have very much on that one, but that's okay. It still works. Any questions? Just going to clean up my scraps here. No questions?
Their video is going to have a bit of lag. So.
Oh, that's right. Okay. I'm going to have just a sip of tea.
They'll be a bit behind us.
So we can place this block in two different ways. We can following our diagram on our paper, I can either have an orange pinwheel in the middle. Or a green pinwheel in the middle. So I could either have it that way, or I could have it this way. Now, if you're making two for your queen size, that's fine. Do one way, one the other. But at this point, I have to decide which one I like. I prefer the orange in the middle. So I am going to do that. So I'm going to move it back. And I'm just going to pile these piles all together. And I'm going to sew them into quadrants. So what I want to do is I want to sew my greens to my orange along this seam right here. When I do this, I want to make sure that when I sew, I'm going to sew with the goose that has the point in the seam on the top. Again, here's a really good, because I use the darker thread on this fabric, my seam, when I sew it, I want it to be basically right there. Just to say it's one thread before the intersection of those two seams. So if I sew with this one on the top, I can keep an eye on it and make sure he's behaving and going in the right direction. So I'm going to line. If you want, you can put pins in. I'm going to live dangerously.
I zoomed too far.
All right. So I've started my seam. My needle's going to hold it. I want to make sure my edges are all aligned. Nothing's too far, too close. And I am going to hold right where my seams intersect with my finger. At this point, I can adjust a little bit if I have to,
to make sure that my seam that I'm sewing right now goes exactly where I want it to be. Take out so you can see. So the seam that I just sewed crosses one thread before that intersection of the two previous seams. Got it? Got it. Okay. Two more units.
We do have someone else asking about the tutorial for the boards. Do you remember the name?
Yeah, Lori Holt. Be in my bonnet studios, I think, but it's Be in My Bonnet, and put quilt boards or design boards, and I'm sure her video will come up on YouTube. I purchased the foam core plast at our dollar store here in Espanola, and I think I got four boards out of one piece of core plast, if I'm not mistaken. Two. Thank you. I can see those ones. Now we have our four pieces, and let's talk a little bit. Let's have a discussion about pressing. Press seams open, press seams to the side. There is a lot of decisions about that. I'm just going to use this block and explain to you my thoughts on pressing seams open or to the side. So, normally we press to the side. Some people will say where they have a big point like this, they want to press, or if you have a lot of points coming together, you may want to press open. So here's my thought about open. When you press your seam open, the only thing in that gap is your thread. If when my quilt is done, I wanted to quilt in the ditch, I no longer have a ditch that I can sew on. So I either sew on one side or the other. You cannot sew in the ditch. Your needle could even puncture one of the threads that are in there, cut it, and then your seams would come apart. Another thing that with a seam like this, you can see that there's nothing there. There's just literally the thread holding it together. So you could have some bearding of your battings coming through your seam. Bearding is when you get those little tufts and puffs and threads coming up and you wonder why. Sometimes it can come right through the fabric or where there's a quilting stitch, but it could also beard through that seam. So that is the two reasons why I don't like pressing to the side. I do, or pressing open. I do press like that if I absolutely have to. And on certain blocks you do, but I try to figure out a way not to do that if I can. So I'm going to press to the side. I have a lot of bulk here and I have nothing here because there's two seams coming. So I am going to press towards the green. So set my seam and press this open. Press my seam. Open again, because there's a little bit of seam here, my corner wants to flip down, so I make sure that I can physically feel with my fingers which direction my seam's going, so I keep it in the right direction. There we go. Okay, at this point, I'm going to pause for a second, and I am going to grab my square up ruler. You can see on the cutting instructions I have right at the bottom, it says the units of the two geese. So these quadrants, they measure 6.5 by 6.5. So I want to measure these at this point and make sure that they're right. So mine measures, of course, we already just squared up this direction. So it should measure 6.5, not a problem, in this direction because I have the seam. Excuse me. It might be off a little bit here. So when I measure it now, if it is off, I am not going to trim it with my cutter. If I was off a little bit and it was measuring a little bit too big, if I cut, when I sewed this into the next unit, I would lose the tip of my triangle. I'd lose his nose and I don't want to do that. So if I measure this and my block is too big, that's, oops. Sorry. Got that?
Yeah.
Okay. So if it measures too large, this seam here that I just sewed would have been too small. So I'm going to stop at this point. I'm going to re-sew that seam. If my unit doesn't measure 6.5, that means that seam is too big. So I am going to adjust at this point, unsew it and sew with a little scanter seam to make sure that these units measure 6.5 by 6.5. Okay, so let's.
Leanne LaBallister asks, is it okay to press on both sides? I'm not sure exactly what you mean, Leanne.
Okay, so if you press on this side right now, with it not being pressed, there's a chance that you might get foldy overs in there. So I always first like to set my seam on the back. I will open this up and I will press this seam perfect. You can then turn your block over and make sure your seams are going in all the proper direction and fix them if they're not. But you really do want to press on this side first so I can make sure that I can visually see that my seam is open all the way. I hope that explains it. Alrighty, so
you were saying how to fix it if it's too big or too small.
Yes. Okay. Again, just to recap, if I measure my block and because we just squared these up and we didn't sew anything on the side, it should measure exactly 6.5 perfect. If it doesn't measure 6.5 in this direction, that means my seam in the center is either too small or too big. So if I'm measuring more than 6.5, my seam will be too small. So I want to re-sew it. Just perfect. If my block is not measuring 6.5, and we know that we cut these units at 3.5, then that means my seam that I sewed my two units together was too
my seam was too large. This one isn't measuring quite exactly here. I am going to just give that another little press just to make sure that this opened up. If that doesn't fix it, then I'm going to re-sew that seam. Okay, so I'm perfect here. I'm still out here. So I am just going to unsew a little bit of this seam. Everything else is perfect up till about that spot. My corner probably shifted on me because of the bulk when I was sewing it together. So I can take my handy dandy seam ripper. I am going to just re-sew. Thank you, Tiffany. So I don't have to untake the whole seam. It was just this end that was off a little bit. So I will start sewing and overlap my seam about an inch. There's enough bulk in the center, so I don't want to do the center if I don't have to. So I've lined that up perfectly. Let's realign this corner. Again, because there's the seam on the bottom one, your fabric tends to want to shift. So you can hold it really tight with your finger. Also grab my purple thing, and I'm going to hold that where I want it to be. Measure it up. Let's measure it and see if it made any difference. So I'm a little bit closer. I'm okay with that now. That being said, if you were out that little bit, I don't know if you could see, if you were out that much, that little bit, you could probably just stretch into your next block. If you have one corner that's just out and you've tried to sew it a few times, here's a little tip. If I know this is a little short on this side here, I will put a little pin, and that will remind me when I'm sewing my blocks together that I have to do something special there. So let's align up our blocks according to our paper. We have them flying west, north, east, and south. Whoops, south. So I'm going to sew this unit to this unit, and I'm going to sew this unit to this unit. So here's our pin. Now I remember, oh yes, there's a pin there. That's because that side was a little bit short. I can butt these two seams up here, and I am going to put a pin. And if this side was the side that was short, when I align it up, I remember there was just a few threads. So I am going to actually just smoosh it down that little bit and align it up this way. So that two threads is going to be a little smaller in seam allowance. Nobody's going to notice that at the end of the day.
Oh, what a brag. Leanne said, thought I would share. It's sunny in Vancouver and the flowers are sprouting up.
Oh, Leanne. Yeah, there's no flowers here.
Not anywhere near yet.
I think we got, oh, I don't know. What did we get? Probably about 5 or 6 inches of snow yesterday. And it's really great big flakes again today. So I think they were saying that we should have about, I don't know, was it 10 centimeters or something again by the end of the day? No flowers here. Again, I have a really thick point here with my seams. I am just going to grab my purple thing that magically disappeared. Where did it go? There it is. I want to make sure that that seam is going in the direction that I want it to go in. And I can grab this unit. And now I'm going to sew this seam. Again, my two seams are pressed in the opposite direction, so they're going to butt together very nicely there. I love how the seams nest. You'll learn with your fingers that you can actually feel where they, when they just lock in. It's just, it feels just perfect. Now I have a seam here in the middle. I want to stop and I want to make sure it's going in the direction that I pressed it. Wrong direction. So here we have our two units. I get rid of that pin. Again, I have a point there that wants to go in that direction. So I am just going to live with it and I am going to press my seam towards my orange. And you can see at this point that my seams will be going in a circle. They're all facing in the same direction. And then these ones are facing in this direction. That's really cool. And I'll show you why in a minute. So we're going to press towards our orange. We know we want to press towards our orange. So that's on the top. I didn't lose any points because I have that wonderful ruler and everything was squared up really nicely. Again, pressing towards the orange. These units right now will measure 12 and a half. You could measure them at this point and see if they're going to measure 12 and a half. I'm going to live dangerously. We're going to sew it together like that. Alrighty, let's get some, I don't know if you can see close up. I know it gets really foggy when we do close up, but we're going to try. Okay, we have this intersection right here. So basically we want to align this point with this point, and we can do what we call pin match. So this one's going to the top, folding like the book, and I have these seams right here that I can see. So I'm going to take my pin, and right on the inside where those seams intersect, I'm going to place my pin, and it will be right in the point of my goose. Okay, I'm going to take my pin and I'm also going to find that identical point in this seam right there. I'm going to hold my unit and I'm going to wiggle it until my pin is exactly perpendicular to my seam. I don't want it to be at an angle like this because my points aren't aligned up. Now, because we pressed and they're going around in a circle, all of these seams are nesting really nicely. So that pin automatically goes where we wanted it to go. But if somebody ever, if you're ever reading and they say something about pin matching seams, that's what you're doing. So now that I know that that's absolutely perfect, I'm going to take a second pin and I'm going to pin. And sometimes people pin on both sides. I am going to just, because it's a long block, I'm going to pin this side just to keep it where I want it to be. And I'm going to align this side up. And off I go to my sewing machine. And I have no thread in there again. What did I do? It's got to be the weather, I tell you. I think this time it just pulled out of my needle. I have to laugh. Did you see me? I went to go put my foot down. I've been sewing all weekend at home and my machine at home has doesn't have the automatic foot down. So So I went to go lift it. And I thought, oh, what the heck? Anyways, that's just me. I'm digressing. All right, corner matched up. Make sure my seam's going in the direction that I have it pressed. Butt it up against my needle. Going to grab my purple thing. At this point, I'm going to give this a little tug, make sure everything's lying nice and flat. And I'm only going to concentrate in sewing to my seam. Now that I sewed over the seam, I can align this section up. Lot of bulk here. I have to remove that pin. I can feel with my fingers that things are going in the right direction. I have that X of seams that I want to make sure that I intersect perfectly. I have another seam here. Make sure it's going in the right direction. So there we have it. So now what we're going to do, now I believe in our very first block, was it our very first block? Did we spin points yet? I think we did on the hourglass blocks.
Yeah.
On the hourglass blocks. We're going to spin this point again because we have 8 points coming to the center. You can see how bumpy it is. It doesn't want to press straight. So we're going to spin that seam. Again, so I'm just going to grab a pin and I want to unsew the 2 seams down to the seam I just sewed. So that was the last seam that I sewed crosswise, and I'm going to unsew this one down to that seam, and I'm going to unsew this one down to that seam. That's again instrumental that we make sure that all those seams were going in the direction and nothing got pressed in the wrong direction. If it did get flipped, we would have to unsew. We can't flip our seams anymore. So this time I'm going to go to the back. I'm going to start on the back so you can see that the seams are going in that direction. If I press all my seams going in that circle clockwise, and it doesn't matter if it went clockwise or counterclockwise, if we had them going in the other direction, depending on how we press these seams, it doesn't matter. But you can see now that I have this little tiny pinwheel in the center. I'm just going to take a little bit of press just to make sure that that's down where I want it to be. And I'm going to press from this side. So this on this side is going down. And this seam on this side will now be sewing or pressing up. And now I could give it a little bit of steam if I wanted to, make sure it's nice and flat. But I don't know if you can tell on camera, but I don't have so much bulk right there in the center. Where are those? The other triangle from here. I can see it. The red triangles that I threw away.
Oh, the ones that you threw.
The ones that I threw away. I want to just talk about this neat product that I
probably fell through the table.
I've got one here. I can cut it in half. Got it? I think we have a couple minutes that we can do a product placement here.
Just let anyone know that if they have any questions, they can ask now.
Exactly. So we've got a few minutes left that we can do any questions that anybody has. And until we see some questions, I'm just going to gab for a minute. Acorn Precision Piecing Products. This, can you see that? This is actually a Canadian company from out west. And this is our seam align glue. So when we pin match the seam, I could have used this instead of pinning. I call it actually pins in a bottle. So it's really, really cool. It makes life so much easier. These blocks aren't cut to the right size. They're not going to work absolutely perfectly. But I just want to show you how this product works. So with this, especially being a bias, and if we wanted these edges nice and straight, or if you have problems when you're sewing that your seams shift, this might be the product for you. So all you do is take this and put little tiny dabs, and this is probably, I haven't used it in a while. I meant to show you this earlier. Uh-oh, let me just grab a pin. I'll clean out my edge, my end. I meant to have this ready and I was going to use it today and I completely forgot. So you can see that I'm putting these little tiny dabs of, for lack of a better word, glue. But when, how do I put this? It's not glue per se that it's going to leave any stickiness on our needle. It's not going to leave any bulk in our seam whatsoever. When I give this a press with the iron, it is actually sealed onto our fabric. If I pull it apart, you can feel it. I guess you can't feel it, but I can feel it. There's nothing there. There's absolutely no residue left. When you give it a little press, it presses into the fabric. If I pressed it again, now it will not restick. It's gone. Once I peel it open, it's gone. But so if I do use the pins in the bottle and we just dab it on, this isn't working again.
I'm going to have to clean that tip.
I'm just going to soak my tip. I haven't used it in a while. I'm just going to soak it in some warm water for a few minutes and it'll clean right up. There we go. So I'm going to put my little balls, my little pins, liquid pins. I would put my lining up my edges absolutely perfect. I would actually line them up on my and press them so my seams are totally lined up perfect and they don't come undone. I also use it sometimes for doing binding, but it would have been absolutely perfect when I was trying to align this up. I could have put my glue on my whole seam. I could have put the dabs of glue here and here, align them up perfectly, hit it with the iron, and life would have been good. I would have used it on the whole seam. Next week, when we're doing your block, I'll try to remember to use this. This is really super cool to use when you're doing little tiny pieces. The smaller the piece, the harder it is for our fat fingers to hold onto it. So this is really cool. So I will be using that again later on in our weeks to come.
Does it hold as strong as pins?
No.
You can pull it apart.
You can literally pull it apart, but there is, you can see that I do have to give it a little tug. So depending on what you're doing, no, but we're not going to be pinning with pins every half inch. Whereas this, we can pin with pins every half inch and then our seam's not going to slide whatsoever. Remember when we are pinning with the pins, if I pre-pin my seams, it can still shift in the middle. So I have to always make sure that those are lined up. If I have my whole seam glued, it's not going to move whatsoever. I like it. I like it all. I find it's really great for beginning people, that especially when they're sewing borders and things, because you don't pin, you know, every 2 inches when you're pinning on a border. So as they're sewing long seams together, there's fabric shifts. So this works really well for them, that it keeps their edges all perfectly aligned. So any other questions?
None so far.
Okay, so Tiff has a problem she wants you all to help with. This is her block, but she can't decide which way she likes it. Can you see the whole block?
Yeah.
All right, so there's one with the dark on the inside. And we're just going to rearrange this. With the dark on the outside. So that's number two. So in the comments below, you can vote which one you like. One, which is the dark on the inside, or two, the light on the inside. And next week, we will find out what the verdict is.
Or probably tomorrow on the group, I'll probably.
Oh, she'll post it on the group?
Tomorrow.
Okay. So there you have it. That's our basic flying goose. Thanks for joining me today. Okay. Is there any other questions?
Just someone said that the what's it called?
The seam align glue.
The seam align glue is great for the drunkard's path.
Oh, it would be too, wouldn't it? Because you could just move everything in, just jiggle all those seams in. It would be really great for that.
Thanks for your votes, everyone. I'll have to tally it later.
All righty. So on that note, almost 20 after 2. So we'll... And... spending all your time out shoveling driveway, but walking in those snowflakes would be kind of cool. But take some time for quilting. We'll see you next week. Now, happy quilting. Bye now.